Good morning and happy Sabbath to the brothers and sisters in Savannah, Sauk Valley, and Moline. As the Apostle Paul so often said, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. In high school, I ran track for 2 years, and one of the races that I often ran was hurdles. I can't remember how long the route was, 110, 220, can't remember for sure, but so few people were running hurdles from our opponent's teams that very often I would be the only one that ran the race, and of course I would get first place because there's no one there. But this had an adverse side effect. I remember one race in particular where we actually went against another high school where they had a person who was running hurdles. But you see, by that point, I had become apathetic. By that point, I had been accustomed to running alone. And I was, at that point, developed a habit where I would flippantly and half-heartedly run the race. Well, when we went against this high school team who actually had a hurdle runner, that habit was ingrained and it showed at that race. I put very little effort in it, and of course I came up second place, also known as last place. We live in a time now of relative peace. We live now in a time of relative security, and it could easily develop, it can easily result in a prayer life that is flippant, a prayer life that is half-hearted. But a time of great trouble awaits God's people, a time that will test our faith in the promises of God. It is now, during this relative peace, it is now, during this relative security, when we need to develop the habit of standing alone on the promises of God. We must battle the temptation to become lax. We must battle the temptation to become apathetic. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Let's turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18, our scripture reading, was Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 18. I'm going to start there at verse 1. Luke chapter 18 and verse 1. I invite you all to pull out your Bibles or pull out your Bible apps so we can look at this together. Luke chapter 18, I'll be reading there verse 1. Jesus had just finished giving to his disciples the signs of his second coming, the things that we can expect to happen, the things that we can expect to see just before Christ comes again. And one of the things he stressed in giving these signs was a need for vigilance, for you know not the day nor the hour. And he follows up with a parable that emphasizes the importance, the important aspects of prayer for God's people as they await the second coming of Christ. Luke chapter 18, verse 1, then, that is after he gave the signs of the second coming, then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not lose heart. Or I have the King James Version in my lodged in my head, men ought always to pray and not to faint. There is applications, there is implications in this parable. The day of the Lord will catch many, many people by surprise. And as that day draws near, there is a deeper and more and yet deeper need for perseverance in prayer, for a prayer that claims the promises of God and lays hold on it. God's people are soon to go through a time of trouble as they await the day of the Lord, a day in which there will be no visible token of God's favor, no visible sign of his deliverance, as Christ at the cross went through a time, went through a period when he felt that the Father's presence was withdrawn from him. So too, in the last days, just before Christ's second coming, God's people are going to go through a time when it will appear to them that they may have been abandoned. That day will call for faith. That day will call for diligence. That day will call for perseverance. That day will call for prayer. Jesus, in this parable, harps on a characteristic that must mark the personal, devotional life of his remnant. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Then he spoke a parable to them, that men always ought to pray and not to lose heart, saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. We find in this parable three characters. The first I want to mention is the unjust judge, as he's referred to in verse 6. The unjust judge, he exercised arbitrary rule. His heart was unmoved by injustice. He had no regard for right and for wrong. He ignored his responsibility to watch out for the helpless, to watch out for the hurting, for watch out for those who had injustice administered to them. He was indifferent to their pleadings. Finally, he consented to the pleadings that were being shouted in his ear day after day. Finally, he gave in to those pleadings, not out of compassion, but for selfish reasons. This unjust judge gives us a picture of God not by representation, but by contrast. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 10, verse 18, we're told that the Lord administers justice for the fatherless and for the widow. The Lord's heart is moved with compassion when he sees those who are struggling, when he finds those who are afflicted. The Lord's heart is moved for us when we are going through struggles, and he has great pity for us. He is not annoyed in any way when we cry out to him, but is drawn to us with compassion. Jesus' point in this parable is to say that if the unjust judge, who is indifferent and uncaring, if the unjust judge finally became willing to deliver the widow, how much more willing will the Lord be to deliver us? The second character I want to mention was, the second character I want to take a look at is mentioned only in passing in verse 3. He's mentioned only in passing and very, very briefly with an indirect reference, and that is the adversary. The adversary sought to take advantage of the widow, whose husband, apparently when he passed away, left a debt for her to be responsible for. And the adversary wanted to take advantage of this. The adversary saw an opportunity to get some property and apparently perhaps one or more slaves. The adversary represents the cruel intentions of the devil and his agents. The devil is sadistic. The devil is self-centered. The devil is his characteristics are going to be manifested more and more as we come to the last days. Every heartless desire of the devil will be manifested more fully as we come closer to the day of Christ. from what this parable is telling us, God's people will appear to be at the mercy of those who have no mercy before Jesus' second coming. So there's the unjust judge, there is the adversary, and then there is the widow. And to get a full impact of what this widow is going through, it's important to us to take a look at the lot of the widow in the ancient East. The lot of the widow was often a very difficult one because in the ancient Near East, there was no such thing as Social Security. There was no such thing as government subsidies for housing. In the ancient Near East, women rarely worked and earned money. They were very dependent on either their father or their house or their husband in order to have any type of material blessings. Yes, God established laws in Israel to protect the widow. He said you're not to afflict the widow. He said you are not to take her clothing when she takes out a loan for you. So you're not to take her clothing as a pledge that she'll pay it back. He had the law in which every third year there was to be a tithe for the widow and for the offerings, for the orphans. He pointed out that to the farmers that you are to allow the widows, such as Ruth, to glean your fields at harvest time. But these laws were not always faithfully observed in Israel, where there was little mercy, where greed predominated. The life of a widow was very often one of grief and hardship. This widow is the character that we are called to identify with as God's people. This widow's only hope to be free from the chance of slavery, this widow's only hope was in this judge. She was powerless in and of herself against the efforts of the adversary to take all she has and perhaps put her into slavery. Jesus used this illustration in this parable to show how weak and how helpless we truly are, though we may not realize it, how dependent we truly are on Him and on our Savior, Jesus Christ. The widow's pleadings represents what the prayers of God's people ought to be. Prayers that cling to His promises regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the way things look. Prayers that hold fast to His word with earnest pursuit. Prayers that will not be denied. Prayers that are not flippant. Prayers that are not half-hearted. She continually pressed her case despite being repulsed time and time again. Here, her importunity, her perseverance are an example for God's people in the last days. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Let's continue in verse 6 through 8. In Luke chapter 18, verses 6 through 8. Then the Lord said, "Hear what the unjust judge says. And shall God not avenge His own elect, who cry out day and night to Him, though He bears long with them? I tell you that He will avenge them." How? He will avenge them speedily. I remember in our previous district, at times we would drive from Springfield to Jacksonville and on Interstate 72 heading west. And I remember seeing a sign there that said 90 degrees longitude. You are halfway around the world. Now, there's a little mix-up there. It should be 180 degrees. But anyway, everybody know what longitude means? Anybody know what latitude means? Longitude is a measurement in degrees that goes from east to west. So if you're looking at a map, longitude. So it goes east to west. So it gives you an idea of where you are in the earth. Latitude is north and south. And so if you want to specify where someone is on the earth, give a degree in longitude and give a degree in latitude. So for example, the equator at mean would be 0 degrees longitude, 0 degrees latitude. I may be getting a little too technical here. But the story goes of a time when two men who were in the same longitude and same latitude, in a sense in the same spot, to give them a description of the sky. And one guy looked up and said, "It is overcast. I cannot see a thing. It is extremely cloudy." The other man, who was in the same longitude at that time and the same latitude at that time, same longitude, same latitude, same moment, looked up and said, "I can see every star. It is a beautiful sky." How can that be, someone might ask? Well, because there are different altitudes. One was in his front porch on the ground looking up and saw just the clouds. The other was a pilot in the plane, was above the clouds, and he was able to see the sky perfectly. Same longitude, same latitude, different altitude, different perspectives. Now, when we look at this parable, we may see what appears to be a contradiction. Because Jesus is talking about God's own elect who are crying how often? Day and night unto him. But then in verse 8 he says, "I tell you that he will avenge them," how? Speedily. This seems to be a contradiction. How can they be crying out day and night, and yet God avenges them speedily? If he avenges them speedily, why do they need to continue to cry? Because it's two different perspectives, and we're at two different altitudes. We are here on the ground, and he is above the clouds. God responds to our pleas speedily when he knows they need to be answered. He does not allow the adversary. He does not allow the devil and his agents to badger us, to afflict us unnecessarily. He does not allow these things to be prolonged if it's not going to carry out any good. From our perspective, we're crying out day and night. But from his perspective, when it's time to answer, when it's time to get it done, he answers speedily. He does it speedily. It is during this time when we are crying out day and night that we will be tempted to believe that our prayers are not being answered. We may at this point come to view or come to believe or to question the promises of God. We may feel that God has deserted us, that God has forsaken us, that God has turned us away or turned away from us. But these are the experiences where we must not allow feelings to dictate, but faith. During this time, we may be tempted to faint or to lose heart, as some translations say. Literally, that phrase, faint and lose heart, literally means to be utterly spiritless. We may have no sense of his presence, as Jesus had at the cross. We may be overwhelmed with discouragement. We may not be witnessing his hand at work, his hand moving in response to our pleas. But this is when our faith must go beyond sight and hold on to the belief that he still has our good in mind. During this time, God's silence is just what we need, because it provokes us to search our heart. It provokes us to examine if we are placing any obstacles before Him. It provides us time for reflection. It provides us time to see our challenges in the light of all that He does. It exposes our true character and level of faith. It exposes how genuine our faith truly is. From the book Christ Object Lessons, page 175, we read the following: "There is no danger that the Lord will neglect the prayers of His people. The danger is that in temptation and trial, they will become discouraged and fail to persevere in prayer." When I was quite young, I remember a couple of us kids coming to my father. My father, I want to point out to you, was a man who can be quite sarcastic, quite cynical, and it took me a while to learn that as a kid. And so one time, a couple of us kids came to him and said, "Hey, Daddy, can we have a pool?" And he said, "Certainly, first thing tomorrow morning." And we said, "Yes." So we're all rejoicing. We're all very, you know, just anticipating, looking forward to tomorrow morning when we're going to have a pool. Well, that next morning, I grew up quite a bit. That next morning, I learned that the saying, "first thing tomorrow morning," was another way of saying, "no way, no way." I grew up quite a bit, and I learned that there are some things, some promises that you cannot rely on. Well, the promises of God are certain. The promises of God are true. The promises of God are trustworthy. The promises of God will never fail. And the promises of God are safe to embrace. The promises of God have been given to us by one who never lies, by one who loves us supremely, by one who longs for us. But the promises of God will only be realized by those who pursue them, by those who firmly set their hope on them. From the book Patriarchs and Prophets, page 203, we read the following: "The greatest victories to the Church of Christ or to the individual Christians are not those that are gained by talent or education, by wealth or the favor of men. No, they are those victories that are gained in the audience chamber with God when earnest, agonizing faith lays hold upon the mighty arm of power." An effective prayer life consists of more than whimsical requests here and there. It will refuse to accept the idea that they have fallen through. An effective prayer life lays hold of the promises of God and makes them its foundation. An effective prayer life will not let go of the Word of God regardless of the challenging storm. An effective prayer life cries day and night until the answer, the swift answer from the Father, is realized. My brother in Savannah, my sister in Sauk Valley, my friends in Moline, are you struggling with discouragement? Do you feel that you are about to faint? Do you feel that you are about to lose heart? Have you gone through seasons, or are you going through seasons where it appears that God has forsaken you, where it appears that the promises of God have failed you? God will answer you speedily, and maybe God has answered you speedily. Men ought always to pray and never to faint. I can't remember if this was before I was baptized or after I was baptized. The pastor that did baptize me, I was sitting down with him and talking with him at one time, and then he asked a question that I was just not ready for. He said, "John, where do you see yourself 5 years from now?" I had not thought of that. Where do I see myself 5 years from now? And I honestly answered him, I don't know. But that question provoked me. That question helped me to see how short-sighted I had been at that point in my life. I was married, I got my job, I had my children. Well, what more did I need? But where do you see yourself 5 years from now? Jesus finishes his parable with a deep and penetrating question. Verse 8, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Jesus' question has been echoed by the prophets of God throughout the ages. Joel chapter 2, verse 11, for the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Malachi chapter 3, verse 2, but who may abide in the day of his coming, and who shall stand when he appeareth? Isaiah 33, verse 14, who among us will dwell with the everlasting fire? Who among us will dwell with the consuming burnings? These are questions that have been asked throughout the ages. How shall we stand in that great day? One of the hymns are sung. In what way will I react when he comes in the clouds of glory, taking vengeance on them that know not God? Will I look up in the clouds and say, behold, my God whom I have waited for? Will I be rejoicing that day, or will I be praying to the mountains and rocks and saying, fall on me and hide me from the face of him who sit upon the throne? These questions, this question that Jesus asked, these questions that the prophets asked, these questions that the hymn writers asked, these questions are intended to provoke us. These questions are intended to lead us to critically look at ourselves. These questions we must engage now. These questions must be pondered before Christ comes, because if we do not ponder them now, the answer to Jesus' question will be no. He will really not find faith on the earth when he comes. Our prayer life today will very much determine the answer to Jesus' question. Our prayer life today will either develop our faith or minimize our faith. Our prayer life today must be persevering and persistent. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. In ancient times, a king had a boulder placed in the roadway, and then he went and hid himself and watched to see if anyone would remove the huge rock. Well, some of the king's wealthiest merchants and courtiers came by and simply walked around the boulder, and many loudly blamed the king for not keeping the roads clear. But none did anything to move the stone out of the way. Well, finally, a peasant came along carrying a load of vegetables, and on approaching the boulder, the peasant laid down his burden and tried to move the stone to the side of the road. Well, after much pushing and straining, he finally succeeded. And after the peasant picked up his load of vegetables again, he noticed that there was a purse lying in front of him where the boulder had been. The purse contained in it many gold coins and a note from the king indicating that the gold was for the person who removed the boulder from the roadway. Our king allows obstacles in our life, not to torment us, but to enrich us, to lead us into deeper faith, and to point our trust, to direct our trust entirely and exclusively to God. to him. Jesus is looking for faith that will welcome him when he comes. Now is the time that we can have persevering faith. Now we need to develop that persevering faith. Now can we have a faith that will eventually discover that gold. Let us make our prayer lives seasons of wrestling. Let us make our prayer lives seasons of taking hold upon the promises of God. Let us today have a prayer life with faith that will not be denied. Let us live by the promises of God, regardless of what the circumstances may tell us of them. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, we plead with you that now, during this time of relative peace, now during this time of relative security, that we will learn, even when we're tempted to be lax, to firmly take hold of the promises of God. Help us, Heavenly Father, so that in times of test, in times of trial, in times of obstacles, in times when we come across that boulder, we will know, we will believe that you have our good in mind, and that we will live by every word that proceeds from your mouth rather than going with what appears to be the smooth waves in this culture, in this time, and in this society. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.